Good evening, and welcome to the Havin' a Drink with Mink 1500 subscriber special. I'm your host, Jason Mink. Thank you for joining us. First off, I'd like to apologize for the delay in new episodes. As Dean Martin might say, I've had a lot of big deals cooking. We don't have a studio space at the moment, but I wanted to take the time to make this episode to thank all of our new and returning viewers. 1500 is quite the milestone for our little channel, and one way or another, we hope to keep the fun going for a long time to come. So let's get right to it. I hope you have a nice beverage on hand. I know that I do. First up, something from our friends at Mego. This is the Hammer Films version of the Frankenstein monster. The figure comes on a printed blister card with imagery more suggestive of the Universal version of the character than this later Technicolor incarnation. On the back, we get an eye-catching photograph of actor Christopher Lee as the aforementioned monster. Did you know that Mr. Lee played both Frankenstein and Dracula in the Hammer films? I'm sure you did. You're no noob. Off the card, and the figure appears very much as he did in the film. It's an interesting look that Hammer chose to go with. Not having the rights nor the inclination to copy Universal's design, the film's creators went with something more visceral and visually aggressive, giving their creation lots of scars and a deathly blue-gray pallor, along with a hairstyle suggestive less of Karloff and more of Joan Baez. They even kind of dress alike. Throw him an acoustic guitar and he can sing a duet with Dylan at the Newport Folk Festival. But I kid. I kid Hammer Frankenstein. Unsurprisingly, the character is built on the standard Mego buck, with only the head, hands, and outfit to differentiate. It's the same formula used on previous Frankensteins and even recycles the boots and hands, which is fine. Boots is boots. And the hands, while unscarred, work well enough. He's dressed as his movie counterpart, in black pants, undershirt, and a sort of modish gravedigger's jacket. The design is suggestive of another Mego offering, the company's original Frankenstein from way back in 1974's Mad Monster line. The wrists are pretty stuck right out of the package, so it's imperative that I heat them up before I attempt to move them. Longtime viewers will have seen me break Migos on this channel before, and as you know, that sickening snap stays with you for a long time to come. The head sculpt, while not overdone, has enough detail to convey what it needs, with a solid likeness of Mr. Lee. Sadly, Mego has backed off on making monsters as of late, which is disappointing, as there are still so many cool characters that I'd like to see. I mean, I can't be the only one who wants to see a hideous sun demon or Michael Landon as teenage werewolf. Can I? Next up, original comics art is a world I've not dipped my toe in. Not for lack of interest, mind you. I simply don't have that kind of kale. However, I can certainly appreciate it, especially when the subject is so Riverdale-centric. These are from my boss's collection, and he was nice enough not only to show them to me, but to allow me to share them with you as well. And right out of the gate, it's a winner with this Veronica full-pager from Dan DeCarlo and Rudy LePake. Unlike your typical Marvel or DC, Archie almost always featured multiple stories in one issue. Presumably, when these stories ran short, the publisher just filled the spare pages with pinups. And if Veronica's here, can Betty be far behind? More from Dan DeCarlo, this time from the pages of Betty and Me, number 127. Another longtime feature in books like this were reader fashion submissions. And here we see Miss Cooper modeling some very mid-70s designs. And for all of you authentication fans out there, here's the sticker on the back of the bag. Here's a nifty Harry Lucy page featuring some of the dynamic figure work that the artist was best known for. This one comes from Archie number 205. Following on is a one-pager from Archie 191, notable less for the humor and more for what I found on the back. approved October 25th, 1975 by no less than the Comics Code Authority. Not sure who signed off on it, but still neat to see. Also on this page, a rubber stamp notice from the company themselves regarding reprinting this very artwork. While MLJ is all smiles and sunshine on the surface, don't mess with them. They take their copyrights very seriously. We finish with this awesome story page, which includes just about everybody. My girl Midge is even there, before the Grendel-like apparition of Big Ethel relegated her to third-string status. This one is also signed by DeCarlo, but to make it even more special, look what I found on the back. A sketch. Out of everything we've seen, this sends me the most. A little unpublished nugget in the rich history of Riverdale. And you'll only see it here. This is the part of the show where we look in the box. And we start off swimmingly with Blue Ribbon Comics number 9 from the aforementioned Archie Comics. I no longer have a research department, but if I'm not mistaken, this is the first appearance of aquatic hero Agent Neptune. He's the Aquaman-looking guy. Putting the splash in splash page, this poor SOB appears to leap to his untimely death. But no, this is Outcast, and he's just a freak. Oh, don't tell him I said that. He's real sensitive. At any rate, we catch up with our seaborne protagonist, and the first thing to note is his magnificent stash. This is quite the move on Red Circle's part. In the 1980s, the only culturally significant people still running around with mustaches were Magnum P.I. and Ron Jeremy, so saddling your ocean-based crusader with one was a bold move. When Outcast rides a fake torpedo at a submarine crew to drive them off, he invokes the wrath of our hero, who whomps him and calls him a freak. See? I told you he was sensitive. This Red Circle imprint from Archie did what it could to gain reader interest, but sea-based heroes are a tough sell to begin with. And then, when you bring in the mustache, this guy might as well swim back to Fire Island. It's just not happening. Next up, it's Kirby Crackle personified in the form of Agron, burning up the pages of Captain America number 205. The King's return to Marvel after his tumultuous stint at DC Comics wasn't the slam dunk folks had hoped it would be. Marvel had changed rapidly during Kirby's absence, and the legendary creator's work, once the visual blueprint for the company, was now seen as dated. That said, Jack still did his part. He understood that kids like you and I were giving up their hard-won candy money, and from an action standpoint, always seemed to provide a lot of bang for our buck. In our last episode, I showed you a few Captain Marvel comics, as I like the wonky nature of those early issues. Here's number 13, and for sheer cheese value, the moment of the manslayer is worth a solid block of Norwegian Jarlsberg. That said, I think the big story here is the guest appearance by the Black Widow in her swinging 60s costume. Back when she was a brunette and fought crime in a little cape and fishnet stockings, and everything was more or less right with the world. Next up, it's issue number 14 and an odd cover for a Marvel comic, as we've seen much nicer offerings rejected. This one is written by Gary Friedrich, with art by Frank Springer, and tantalizing text by legendary letterer Artie Simek. In this issue, the captain apparently disguises himself as Colonel Sanders. Turns out the K in KFC stands for Cree. Let's skip forward a bit to the beginning of the captain's better-known era, and he's the most cosmic superhero of them all. You know, lest you get him confused with David Bowie. Apparently, Ant-Man was in the previous issue, which means I need it for my Hank Pym cameos collection. Before Marvel ruined him, Hank showed up everywhere to help other characters out with their problems, which is a far better take than whatever nightmare scenario the company's foisted on him as of late. Anyway, turns out in this issue, the Captain takes on the Watcher. And not to be indelicate, but the one thing this guy hasn't been watching is his weight. I think he secretly spies on the other Marvel heroes in the Twinkies ads and shows up afterwards to eat whatever's left over. My omnipotence is as nothing next to this delicious, creamy filling. And hey, I'm right there with him. I'm like 35% sponge cake myself. Here's a book that I've been meaning to read for about 40 years. Not sure how I missed it, but it's Marvel Team-Up. Our tale takes place at the circus, where both the Fantastic Four and the Parkers are set to enjoy the show. An unexpected emergency sees the FF needed elsewhere, but Franklin starts freaking out about leaving before seeing the little clowns get out of the car or something, and Aunt May offers to watch the horrid little brat so his parents can go and save the world. However, it's all a ruse to get Franklin alone, as Galactus appears with plans to make the kid his herald. Inexplicably, it's Aunt May who receives the power cosmic, transforming into the awe-inspiring Golden Oldie. Of all the characters that they've brought back over the years, tell me they haven't brought back Golden Oldie. What's the deal here, Marvel? Come on, I'm going to call ageist on you. Pretty weird, but hardly the oddest book offered as part of the Assistant Editor's Month, a little gimmick that injected a bit of mirth into the otherwise dark and gritty 1980s. When it comes right down to it, we have a lot to thank Mr. Monster for. I mean, when was the last time you were attacked by succubi or tentacled sea beasts? In addition to protecting us from midnight slavering fiends, Mr. Monster also introduces this book of Basil Wolverton pre-code reprints, setting the tone for the eye-popping strangeness to come. Wolverton's unique take on the weird fantasy genre lends itself to high-quality production, which this book delivers for a great price. Brainbat Savinus concerns a rocket trip to the second planet from the sun, where astronauts get more than they bargain for when they encounter some of the local wildlife. Maybe a set of those fishbowl-style space helmets might have come in handy, although with tentacles like that, it'd probably be tinfoil around a Ferrero Rocher cherry. The brain bats kill their victims and then drive the bodies around like carjackers, which is fine in the short term, but I figure you're going to burn through a lot of astronauts. And while it's easy to get caught up in the unsettling visuals, it's Wolverton's composition that's the real hook for me here. While some may call his style rough or even primitive, I think the minimization of detail to focus the eye on primary and secondary subject matter creates an almost Viewmaster-like quality. I'm surprised that no one has utilized this style in animation, as it would be highly effective. Nightmare World is just that, a surreal exploration into a realm unknown by the waking mind, with all of the inherent wonder and horror within. I think that Wolverton would have done a great job adapting Lovecraft's work. Seeing Basil tackle a tale like The Shadow Out of Time with its impossible geometry and baffling alien creatures would have been a real treat. And the fact is, this book and many others just like it can be found in dollar boxes at cons or for cover price in the back issue bins of your local comic shop. For $3 or $4, you get 5 entire stories, plus a feature on the artist himself, all delivered on high-quality paper. Now compare that to any comic on the market today, and the value becomes evident. As Aunt Mimi might have said, Batman and Spider-Man are all very well and good, John, but they don't make for a varied comic collection. Here's an odd one for me. What can I say? I was taken in by the idyllic cover. Beaver Valley concerns a group of our flat-tailed friends and what they get up to when not serving as mildly distasteful innuendo. Looks like an alright life, all things considered. Swimming all day, hanging out with your pals. Oh sure, there are downsides, of course. I guess you're damned if you do, and you're damned if you don't. I'll show myself out. Another Dell comic, albeit a slightly different subject matter. It's The Dirty Dozen. Not a book I would have expected from Dell, but hey, life is full of surprises. Adapted from the film of the same name and featuring a galaxy of stars like Lee Marvin, Charles Bronson, and the man himself, Ernest Borgnine. It's a darn good likeness, as are most of the characters. That said, if you're a fan like me, be sure to track down Ernest Borgnine on the bus, a remarkable little film featuring the wit and wisdom of the man himself. You will not be disappointed. All right, now here's a book that I discovered while I was packing up for my move, and I thought, man, you know, I'd really like to feature this at some point in time, and what better time than now? It's Skate Man, the brainchild of legendary creator Neil Adams, and published by Pacific Comics in November of 1983. Skate Man was a book designed to take the comics industry by storm. Sadly, the book missed that mark by a considerable margin. Our hero, the aforementioned Man of Skate, is Billy Moon. A Vietnam vet and martial arts aficionado, he hits the anti-hero trifecta thanks to the deaths of not only his mentor, but his girlfriend as well. As our story begins, he's fighting one of those roving urban street gangs so common in the 1980s, but a 2x4 upside his cranium ends his superhero trip real fast. Fortunately, Boy Wonder Paco is on the scene to scoop his senior partner's brains back into his helmet and push him home on his skates. He's taken to a benevolent old woman instead of a hospital. No need for an MRI after your head trauma, just put some herbs on it. Perhaps it's said herbs that plunge Billy into flashback, but how else are you going to get caught up on the backstory? Motivated to do right, young Moon joins the military, but soon enough realizes he's not soldier material. Going home, he listlessly casts about until an old army buddy suggests he take up roller derby. Now, I don't know about you, but when I was growing up, I never saw a men's roller derby. I'm not saying it didn't exist. Who am I to second-guess Neil Adams? What I'm saying is, what was broadcast on my local channels was women's roller derby. So this whole premise doesn't really scan to me. I'm sure the sport requires strength, stamina, skill, and determination, but I see it less as a crime fighter origin and more like something lunch ladies do when they're not in the cafeteria. At any rate, Billy accidentally kills his buddy, then befriends a young potty mouth named Paco, whom he takes under his metaphorical wing, training him in the ancient art of rolling around when he should be, I don't know, at school or something. Girlfriend Angel shows up slashed to death, and it's pretty harrowing, all things considered. Billy breaks down, snapping at Paco and plunging into depression, until an idea begins to form in his head. He'll avenge his girlfriend and get a little more use out of all that skate gear he went into hawk over in the process. And off he goes, leading us back in where we came. After reviving, Billy realizes he's gonna need a bigger boat and builds this motorized skateboard, which is better than roller skates, but still. How about a motorcycle and a couple of Uzis? With that, our DIY hero zips off to wreak his vengeance against the guys who killed Angel. In the process, he sends Paco off with live explosives, which is either a sign of unshakable trust or the most expedient way of getting rid of a sidekick yet. I won't ruin the rest of the story for you. Unsurprisingly, this can still be found in dollar bins throughout the Western Hemisphere. Pacific Comics invested heavily in the book, but even in the days before the internet and snarky internet chumps like myself, word traveled fast about this one, and allegedly pallet loads of the first issue went unsold, speeding the publisher's demise. Honestly, it's easy to see why. The lame premise isn't helped by the hackneyed dialogue. Hands off, jerkhole? I get it. You can't swear, but jerkhole? That's somehow far, far worse. The art didn't do the title any favors either. Once considered the Eric Clapton of comics artists, Adams was either unwilling or unable to deliver as he once had on books like Batman, turning in scratchy, unappealing batch of pages made even less impactful by the diluted watercolor-like palette. That said, if you're an aficionado of the lowbrow and cornball, then this book has you covered in spades. Let's wrap things up with this issue of Super Duper Comics number 7, and this is a Harvey comic from 1945. I had to snag it based on the curiosity factor alone, and these Homer Simpson guys here didn't hurt. Any Shock Gibson fans out there? He's your standard issue patriotic hero throwing a wrench into the Nazi war machine. Shock made his debut 6 years earlier in Speed Comics number one, so he'd been fighting the good fight a year and a half before Captain America pulled on his little red booties. Meanwhile, no less than DeFuhrer himself receives a report on the Schnitzeljammer gun, a new weapon sure to turn the tides of war, although Adolf decides Hitler gun might be a catchier moniker. It's then Shock makes himself known, although if he'd quit fooling around and gotten to it, countless lives might have been saved. Still, after a bit of back and forth, he smashes the place up real good, destroys the Hitler gun, and Dickie birds the whole sausage factory. It's one hell of a ride for 10 cents, and that's not even counting the other features like Steve Case, roving crime reporter in The Poison Pen Murder. Here, try this on your schnozola. See, Neil? Now that's dialogue. And that brings another thrilling installment to an end. Thank you for joining us on this very special episode. If you enjoyed it, stay tuned, as there's much more to come. And if you'd like to support the channel, consider purchasing one of our fine t-shirts, now available in up to 5XL. Until next time, I'm Jason Mink. Cheers.